Engines 1, Medic 1 and 2, and Hazmat Unit 1. Respond to Gateway Drive between mile marker 2 and 3 near Highway 278. We have a report of a multi-vehicle accident with injuries.
This training video will demonstrate generic medical practices on how to properly handle and manage patients who are potentially contaminated with radioactive material. The techniques demonstrated in this video are generic in nature and are in no way intended to replace your local response procedures. Understanding these techniques will help you as a responder function with confidence during incidents involving radioactive material. As a responder, you encounter many kinds of emergencies entailing varying degrees of risk. All emergency situations are potentially dangerous, and some may be complicated by the presence of hazardous material. When you suspect that radioactive material may be present at an accident scene, take the appropriate actions in accordance with your level of training and local procedures to protect people and the environment. While the hazards associated with radioactive material should be respected, knowledge of simple protective actions will allow you to safely administer emergency medical care. This video will identify personal protective equipment needs for responder safety, demonstrate proper patient management, identify techniques for patient transfer to a medical facility, and demonstrate the proper procedures for returning personnel, equipment, and vehicles to service after responding to a radiological accident. Remember, personal protective equipment is necessary for any medical response. In addition to providing protection from biological hazards, the universal precautions protective clothing worn by emergency care providers will also provide protection from radiological contamination hazards. A typical universal precaution protective clothing kit includes disposable coverall or gown, shoe covers, head cap, and the N95 airborne pathogen tuberculosis mask. The N95 mask will also provide some protection against airborne radioactive material. For work inside the hot zone, where higher levels of radioactive contamination are suspected, a higher level of training is required, and the Emergency Response Guidebook, or ERG, recommends SCBA and structural firefighters' protective clothing. The kit also includes glasses with side shields and gloves. It is recommended that the emergency care providers wear multiple pairs of gloves so that the outer pair of gloves can be removed to help control radioactive contamination. If you are required to respond to a transportation accident involving radioactive material with injured persons, you will need to perform an on-scene assessment and triage of the injured. You should treat patients according to your organization's medical protocols. First, determine how many patients are present and if patients are ambulatory or non-ambulatory. Decide whether you must perform a rapid extrication or if you have time to perform field decontamination before transport. Remember, the Emergency Response Guidebook, or ERG, states, "Medical problems take priority over radiological concerns at a radioactive material incident. Use first aid treatment according to the nature of the injury, and do not delay care and transport of a seriously injured person." When identifying patient priority during triage, follow your local medical treatment protocols. In cases where multiple patients are present, the use of the mass casualty triage and tagging system may be necessary. Attempt to identify the mechanism of injury or the nature of illness. Look for these conditions to determine if the victim has life-threatening injuries and immediate transport is necessary. Unconscious or altered mental status. Respiratory arrest or distress. Severe hemorrhage that cannot be controlled on scene. Or poor perfusion or associated signs and symptoms of shock. If the patient has life-threatening injuries and is believed to be contaminated with radioactive material, field decontamination will most likely not be performed prior to patient transport. Consider the following when administering patient care: advanced life support care, spinal immobilization, packaging the patient cocoon style, oxygen therapy, and exposing only those areas needed for treatment. If other hazardous material contaminants are present, follow your specific procedures for decontamination of those materials. The patient is then brought to the control line where an ambulance stretcher has been prepared for packaging the victim. If the patient has non-life-threatening injuries, transport can be delayed while appropriate treatment is being provided at the accident scene. Field decontamination should be performed prior to patient transport. The following should be considered while performing gross decontamination. Assess and treat injuries specific to the patient's complaint. Administer high-flow oxygen via non-rebreather mask. Remove the patient's clothing within the hot zone to reduce the spread of contamination. Environmental exposure from contamination may precipitate hypothermia and shock. Keep the patient warm by covering them as soon as possible. Be aware of the potential for additional hazardous material exposure. If time permits, prior to patient loading, EMS personnel can help minimize the spread of contamination inside the ambulance compartment by taking a few steps. Work out of mobile medical kits as much as possible and avoid using internal and external compartments. Stow all unnecessary supplies and equipment and close all internal compartments. Cover the ambulance floor. Cover radio communication microphones with a plastic bag or a rubber glove. And avoid using patient compartment ventilation. If available, the patient is transported by an ambulance crew that has not been in the controlled zone. Intubation of the patient should not be performed in the hot zone unless unable to secure airway by other means. Take protective measures not to introduce inhalation hazards to the patient. Maintain endotracheal tube sterility as trained. Intravenous cannulation should not be performed in the hot zone. Cleanse the selected site thoroughly using alcohol or betadine. Remove outer gloves prior to intravenous cannulation. Take protective measures not to introduce hazards intravenously. Administer fluids as directed by local protocols. Many hospitals have procedures in place for dealing with contaminated patients. Early notification is important to allow the hospital time to prepare to receive the patient. Consider the following when transporting contaminated patients. Give a brief but informative description of the patient's condition. Alert hospital of possible contamination and material involved. Identify the number of patients involved in the incident. Transport patients to the appropriate medical facility. And consult with hospital staff for any specific arrival instructions, including alternate arrival entrances, hospital radiation safety support, and unloading of the patient. Upon arrival at the hospital, the ambulance is met outside the emergency entrance by hospital staff. Patients will again be evaluated at this point and admitted for emergency care. A medical report is given as well as information regarding the radiological status if known. Unless needed back at the accident site, bag contaminated items. Secure the ambulance stretcher and transport vehicle. Remove gloves and do not leave the controlled area. To prevent the possibility of internal contamination, you should not eat, drink, smoke, or chew. After being surveyed, and as a matter of precaution, a shower and change of clothing is recommended for ambulance personnel. The ambulance crew and their equipment return to regular service only after they have been surveyed and decontaminated if necessary. Treating patients that have been involved in any hazardous materials accident presents a special challenge requiring planning, training, and practice. The safety of both the public and response personnel may depend on your knowledge and actions. Remember these points. Wear the appropriate level and type of protective clothing when treating potentially contaminated patients. The Emergency Response Guidebook, or ERG, states that medical problems take priority over radiological concerns at a radioactive material incident. During the transport and treatment of potentially contaminated patients, it is important to practice proper contamination control techniques. Provide early notification to the receiving hospital that a potentially contaminated patient is en route. Early notification will allow time for the hospital to initiate its procedures for dressing out inappropriate personal protective equipment and implementation of necessary contamination control practices. Unless needed back at the accident scene, the ambulance crew bags contaminated items, secures the ambulance stretcher and transport vehicle, removes their gloves, and does not leave the controlled area. To prevent the possibility of internal contamination, responders should not eat, drink, smoke, or chew. The ambulance crew and their equipment return to regular service only after they have been surveyed and decontaminated if necessary. By employing these procedures, emergency response personnel can adequately care for the needs of accident victims while affording maximum protection to themselves and victims alike.